up because I think that you really framed the problem very, very well. And I wanted to try this phrase. Patrick and I have debated this on numerous occasions. It seems like you teed up what was a very long-term values-based foreign policy. We had certain consistencies. It's, you know, the impression we get looking from the outside now, not being in the current administration, is that it has shifted to what I would call an effects-based foreign policy, and some of the values-based that you just went through and reviewed, we have left behind at potentially our peril. Is that a reasonable assessment of the current environment?
I hadn't thought of it as effects-based, but I think there's some merit to that thinking, but it's also that also leads, if one is not careful, to near-term transactional things that, when you string these things together, may not connect. I was given a bit of fatherly guidance by a Japanese colleague during one of the times I was stationed in Japan, where he said, the difference between you Americans and us is, for you, everything that happens is a discrete dot. It's an event in time and space all by itself, to be addressed all by itself. For us, that dot is part of a line. It's connected to everything else. And therein lies the difficulty. Nothing's absolute. We're going to have to deal with dictatorships. We're going to have to deal with authoritarian rulers. But we should not, in my opinion, walk away from the foundation that not only formed this country and continues to influence this country, but also, with my fascination with the Bretton Woods Agreement and everything that followed that, we transported that and expanded it into the rest of the world after we damn near destroyed civilization in 1945. If you studied, you know, the military things a little bit, with having to drop two atomic weapons on Japan to get them to surrender, we'd approached practically the Clausewitzian maximum of total destructive war. With everybody else getting nuclear weapons, that wasn't something we wanted to repeat. So one of the things that I think we lost after the Soviet Union collapsed is we kept talking about these things. We had people in government explicitly saying we can't talk about human rights with China because we got to protect our relationship with the Chinese. In my opinion, one of the reasons I became a former government official after a while was that I was pretty liberal with my criticism that we start sounding like the abused spouse in a dysfunctional relationship, that everything's our fault, not your fault. We can still trade with China. We can still do all the diplomatic stuff and everything and all the things that go into foreign relations, but we should not forget who we are, and we should not, and we should continue talking about and acting on human rights because that's who we are. Authoritarian rulers will get it, but we don't need to conform or change what we talk about or change our declarations because they don't like it. Matter of fact, there's nothing that makes a dictator for life more uncomfortable than us speaking rebellious words to his or her constituents, and we should do that. Nothing's going to be clean. Nothing's going to be absolute, and we're going to have the usual mistakes of human nature in designing and making policy and executing it. But if we get the principles right, get the fundamentals right, it's my opinion we'll be better off than we are now. We cannot continue to enjoy our current economy, our current lifestyles, our current freedoms if the trend of the globe getting more and more authoritarian continues. It'll be creating a situation where you're putting dry tinder near a fire. We're to that point, sort of, in the South China Sea right now. It's been declared by a former ambassador to China, who is also the former ambassador to Indonesia. He coined the description, it's the most dangerous area in the world because it's where the vital interests of both China and the United States overlap. we've got a lot of work to do to counter what the Chinese are doing in what's been called the gray zone, something between conflict and peace. We need to be able to push back, maybe not symmetrically, but push back some other way, because this is important. And we can't continue to just treat each thing like the creation of these seven artificial islands in violation of the UN and the UN Convention on the Law of Sea and a number of different things, in violation of a decision by the Permanent Court of Arbitration at The Hague, which, to our shame, we were zip-lip about it when the court came down with an opinion in our favor and in the favor of the Philippines. We got to stop doing this. We got to remember first principles and start acting on it, my opinion. Like I said, I enjoy being retired now because I'm allowed to have an opinion again. So. As long as my lawyer tells me we're still not allowed to speak disparaging words about political leadership. But
so I just had a question really to follow up on that. So I guess the first question is, should we do something about gray zone activities? So I guess primarily in the South China Sea. You could also say this perhaps in Ukraine, with Russia. Mm-hmm. And it sounds like you would say, yes, we should do something to counter it. And then so the next question is if you could just elaborate on what that might be. So you mentioned maybe not in a symmetric way. So what would the asymmetric way look like, and what are the prospects for a positive outcome for us?
We've got the beginnings of some hopefully clever asymmetric pushback going on. For example, after the PCA decision on The Hague came down and we were silent and didn't support the Philippines on this, the Philippines, quite naturally, thinking of self-preservation, President Duterte quite famously started leaning toward China. It's great to be here in California, but back on the other coast, especially in the area right around Northern Virginia and Maryland, people would always say, well, can't you people do something about Duterte? Okay, let's look at it this way. He's got a 90% approval rating. He was democratically elected in a valid election in the Philippines. We, the United States, have a higher approval rating in the Philippines than we have inside the United States. We can't do anything with this. It's you know, just hold onto the desk and let the democratic processes play inside the Philippines. Well, they have. President Duterte is moderating a bit. We just finished another major exercise in the Philippines, and one of the things that was done a few years ago, is during a thing called Exercise Balikatan, we, pardon the jargon, but we brought down a mobile rocket launcher, HIMARS, if you're familiar with it. And we flew it all over the Philippines in a C-130 from here to there and shot a few missiles and go to another place, shoot a few missiles, et cetera, et cetera. This was what's called a demonstration. We were demonstrating to China that they're not the only ones who can do this and that we can engineer things that can reach out and hurt them in the South China Sea if things get too bad. We just recently finished another exercise, so this is one of the pushbacks where we're creating a tighter alliance with the Philippines. We've got some work going on in Vietnam, and we're helped in this regard. It's not just us. We're helped in this regard by the Japanese, who have very quietly made really significant financial investments in the Philippines and in Vietnam, two countries with the longest coastlines on the South China Sea. And this is investment in a Japanese manner. Foreign direct investment, it's loans, it's using the Vietnamese to build things in Vietnam and training them. We're transferring both capability and capacity. Same thing in the Philippines. There's a lot of infrastructure building going on, ports, airfields, all for enhancing commercial trade, but, you know, military aircraft, naval ships, it's a port support, an airfield's an airfield, you know, the implications obvious. So we're starting to push back on this. Personally, I wish that we were more vocal about things that are our strong suit, human rights. At the beginning of the Obama administration, the president himself told a delegation, about 150 people, a delegation, visiting delegation from China for something called a strategic and economic dialogue. He said clearly that we're going to continue to talk about human rights because that's who we are. And then he cited passages from the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution, et cetera, et cetera. And if it wouldn't have broken a lot of decorum, I'd have been in the back, you know, cheering. But we made an explicit decision not so long after that that this would sour our economic talks with China. Huge mistake, in my opinion. Professor Haggerty and I were talking before we started about the Trans-Pacific Partnership. The Trans-Pacific Partnership was drawn from a lot of things that were in the Bretton Woods Agreement. We got 11 nations out on a limb with us at significant political cost in their home country, primarily Japan. And then we decided, no, we're not going to do this. And this is not a partisan argument. The Democratic administration didn't get it to the Senate when they had the political capital to do it. And then in the election, as you recall, the last three viable presidential candidates all came out and blamed trade for the reason there were economic difficulties in America. I'm from Pittsburgh. I grew up in Pittsburgh. It's not trade. It's automation. And Pittsburgh changed after automation, and the silliest thing in the presidential campaign was they're going to bring steel back to Pittsburgh. Pittsburgh didn't want steel back anymore, not the way it was done in the 50s. So we lost a chance to reinforce our values around the world. And now it's interesting, a lot of businesses are saying, hey, it's costing us more to export into Japan because we're not part of a trade deal. Yeah. But this was the TPP was a values-based trade deal. Is everybody going to be a winner? No, you got to do trade adjustment authority in the United States to make sure we protect certain industries and everything. Yeah, but this is the business of government. But you can't do an effects-based policy without considering the long-term effect. And if you treat everything as a transaction, you know, you're done. So it's not hopeless. The Vietnamese, by the way, are very interesting. Army-based country. Some of us have some personal experience. The Vietnamese have, a high tolerance for conflict. They have recently, after the episode with the oil rig being brought into their waters and the Vietnamese objection to it, they bought 5 really neat-looking ships built in Denmark, sort of corvette size, 3 more from Norway, and they imported 6 kilo-class submarines from the Russians. Hello, pay attention. The next time that there's some kind of incident, we might not be in control of events. The Vietnamese could take matters into their own hands, and like I said, they have a proven high tolerance for conflict, and they're now moving into the naval thing because they see the way things are going in the South China Sea. So we need to encourage the right things here, and we need to be pushing back on a wide area and not talking silly things like, well, we'll just go in and invade one of those little features and take over the island. No, that's not going to work. So.
I want to underline something you said for this audience because it's always striking to me that someone from a military background of your length places so much emphasis on the economic instruments, and I think that's just, people need to hear that more. You know? But let me ask you a question about the Bretton Woods Institution. They were universal, and the U.S. saw it as strategically in its interest to integrate China into those institutions.
Yes. At the time, no. When Mao Zedong was in charge, China was a basket case, and we went through the Great Leap Forward and the Cultural Revolution, where he was killing all his own people and everything. And in the Navy, I'm told that folks in this kind of business used to consider Chinese submarines sort of the Helen Keller or the subsea force. They were loud, noisy, and couldn't figure out where they were going. Those days are gone. Deng Xiaoping took over in the late 70s to get rich as glorious, as I said. And then we get to the early 90s, Soviet Union collapsed. And remember, we the U.S. government, had been telling us and ourselves that we had this great the Soviet Union was really big and bad, and we had to tax everybody to support all these things. And in the Pentagon, it made things simple because we had an enemy to model things against. And this year's airplane, this year's ships tended to be a little bit better than last year's ships and last year's airplanes. And it was all predicated on, you know, what the Soviets had and everything. So suddenly all that goes away. We could not have gone to the American public in the early 90s and said, well, the Soviet Union's gone, but about that peace dividend, we got this other nation we need to worry about here. And it was not a totally illogical assumption that as China got rich, China would liberalize. But the big factor, in my opinion, was that we were way too slow to recognize that that was an assumption that did not prove out. But once you, the government's like a gigantic aircraft carrier. Once you get it going in a certain direction, it takes a hell of a lot of effort to even change it 5 degrees. So the idea of people that were talking about, well, we got a, China's big, China's getting wealthy, China's spending on a lot of things. We got a lot of business that wants to sell things into China. We got lost in the fascination with this, and we did not see until way too late, and this is a bipartisan thing from the Clinton administration in the 90s through George W. Bush through Obama and until about now, we haven't started realizing that China's not going to liberalize. And big hint was when Xi Jinping became dictator for life by eliminating the system of succession. And the reason I said no compromise is possible is that he's got to look at the people around him all the time and the one standing right behind him. He starts compromising with the United States, he's going to be gone. He kind of likes his job. So we need to buckle down and get into, again, like I said, in my opinion, remembering who we are and acting accordingly.
Thank you, General, for coming. Follow-up to the previous gentleman's question, if it wasn't a strategic mistake to exclude China from the world order today, is that something that we should still be able to pursue? Exclusion of China from most of the Brentwood's institutions, like the IMF, potentially isolating them in the UN?
We shouldn't dismiss that out of hand, but we ought to insist on seeing some results. I'm not familiar enough with the inner workings and hidden mechanisms of the IMF and these other institutions, but people that are can start asking some questions. Why is China still receiving aid as if they were a undeveloped nation? And we can start, you know, pressing that way. I wouldn't argue for a blanket exclusion necessarily, but just a gradual changing of the way we're doing business and start insisting on proper conduct. By the way, part of it starts with our businesses. It's not okay, never has been okay, for a business or corporation to say that the prime directive is maximizing shareholder value. If that was a prime directive, we wouldn't have things like the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act. We wouldn't have a number of other controls and governing things. We wouldn't have regulatory agencies that look at these things. So we need to look at measures to restrain the zeal of some of our own corporations to give away technology, to give away secrets, to compromise the principles that we build into our economic structure just to do business in China. If the Chinese want to do business, they'll figure it out. They'll do it the right way, my opinion.
Thank you.
Hi, General. My name is Thomas Scheer. I work here at the Center for Peace and Security Studies. Thank you so much for your time and sharing your thoughts. And I'm not confident in this question, so feel free to belittle it. But I agree a lot with what you've said about taking a stance and having the values and remembering who you are. But then there's a flag that goes up that I heard a lot of that language around what I've seen as some costly foreign policy decisions, specifically Afghanistan and Iraq. I remember it stuck with me, the Times cover photo of an Afghan woman after an acid attack with the headline, "Why We Must Stay." And it's just always haunted me of like that the progressive who we are values language can get so wrapped up in these much larger issues. So I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about whether you have any concerns or perhaps why you don't have as many concerns about taking a more boisterous stance, perhaps not boisterous, but a more, bold stance, and more backing up American values. What are the cautions we might want to have or the concerns about whether it's possible to take it too far and be stuck in a position that America doesn't want to be in?
Fair charge. Not every decision that we will take in the future and not every decision that we've made in the past has turned out to be a wise investment of resources, time, lives, et cetera. But I think you can take some comfort in the fact that we're the most self-correcting nation on the planet, and we'll continue to have to do that into the future. One of the reasons I made the somewhat snide remark about the Bretton Woods Conference and planning for the occupation of Germany and Japan and Italy, and planning for how we're going to build the peace before we were even positive we were going to win the war, is that we made a lot of mistakes in the initial occupation of Japan and Germany, but very quickly modified them and corrected them because we were operating on a body of knowledge, and we had some people that we put together that knew how to do it. Henry Kissinger got his start in the force that was in the army that went into occupy Germany with a name like Kissinger and an accent like he has. You know, it's easy to see why. But the recall that we went into Baghdad. I'm sorry, we went into Iraq and we defeated Saddam's conventional forces. And then we started trying to figure out, oh, what do we do with this now that we have it? And we tried to institute a U.S.-style stock market in the land of barter traders. That didn't work. We held off on providing industrial-size generators to produce local electricity so that we could get things like cement plants up and operating so we could make cement and concrete and start rebuilding things. But the decision was made not to do that because it would slow down the recreation of the national electrical grid in Iraq. We shouldn't have been making these decisions after the end of the military operation. It should have been otherwise. Back to the question here about the importance of economics and the importance of the other aspects of national power, if you will, than just the pure military things. Short answer to your question is you're not going to impose democracy at the point of a gun. It may be an essential part of it, but that can't be the only part.
Hi, General. So I really appreciate your comments. I may be mischaracterizing a bit here, but just for the sake of sort of making the question sound coherent, there's a lot of continuity between things that worked in the Cold War and things that you were advocating in the present, and that makes a lot of sense to me. But one of the things that strikes me is that we could point to some things that are different this time. If we call this Cold War 2.0, it's got details that are not exactly the same. The Soviets are not the Russians exactly, and China is not China of the past. Can you point to a couple of things that maybe you think are different and what that would teach us about how to play the game slightly differently this time.
Great question. The Soviet Union made it easy for us because they had an autarkic economy by design. China doesn't. China's getting rich, and everybody wants to do business with China. That's the fundamental difference. The Soviet Union also very quickly divided, did enough egregious things that very quickly divided the world into two camps. China's avoided that to this point, although you could maybe, after some work, figure some way to work the South China Sea and the creation of all these land features out of reefs and submerged rocks. But that's a bit of a stretch. It's not quite the same as the Soviet effort to, successful in many cases, to subvert the countries of Eastern Europe. And the blockade of Berlin was, you know, a big indicator that, unlike what Roosevelt thought, that Uncle Joe was not going to be cooperative and be one of the four world policemen and five world policemen on the Security Council of the UN. So we got to figure out how to do this. There's nothing wrong with doing business with China. We should certainly do that where it's in our interest, but we got to, in my opinion, we've got to define our interest as doing business the right way. Some businessmen have dismissed that position by saying, well, sharing technology, giving away intellectual property is just the price of doing business in China. Well, no. Because when you're doing that, that puts pressure on everybody else. And it's in that sense, it's not yours to give. It's interesting the way the wheel is starting to turn a little bit. We've got a lot of universities now that are starting to look very carefully at on-campus Confucius Institutes and looking at what they might be doing. We've got... A number of the financial regulators are looking at money that comes out of China and where it's going. So this is all proper, and I think it's a way to do it. We don't need to make an enemy of China as a product of reinforcing U.S. values, reinforcing universal values. China's got to exist in the world that has proven successful in preventing yet another global conflagration like we had in the first part of the 20th century. So we might want to be very careful about allowing somebody to dismantle this. And this is why I've come kind of fascinated with the Freedom House statistics on the advancement or the retraction of democratic government around the world. It's going in a direction that's not in our favor, and that can't be good for us short run or long run. Other organizations do polling on opinions of people in other countries, opinions of the United States, opinions of others, et cetera. So we still have a strong base to operate from, but we need to start operating from it, and I think we can do that by getting back to what my friend Robert Thomas called values-based. Doesn't mean you can do everything purely values-based. You got to make some adjustments, but you got to maintain the vector that you're on, and you got to maintain the principle that you're trying to drive to.
So I want to go from the big picture down to the small one. I was very interested in your comment about taking mobile missile launchers to the Philippines to show that kind of capability. Can you speak a little bit more to what just the military side of strategy towards the South China Sea should be?
Sure.
Are there adequate capabilities? Are there capabilities needed? What?
There is that's a great question. There are a dizzying array of changes happening within technologies that are important to the military. Just to show what can go wrong when you don't anticipate very well on what changes they're doing. One of the reasons World War I was so bloody was that everybody thought it was going to be like the Franco-Prussian War and completely missed the fact that railroads did a lot to improve logistics. Mass production standardized artillery calibers. You had barbed wire, you had machine guns, and you know the story. It was, you know, stalemate on the Western Front. Now it's you got space-based capabilities, you got cyber capabilities, you've got microwave capabilities, all these things moving around. But the two, in summary, in my mind, the two biggest things that are causing changes are surveillance that is just everywhere. And if you've got an iPhone in your pocket or an Android, you can get images of Earth on there that were classified not too many years ago because it was only people with big satellites that could get those images. Now everybody's got them. And along with the surveillance, which means if you can be seen, you can be found, we've got weapons that are accurate at distance. So large things that can be found and can't move and things and can't be defended are going to be at risk. So one of the answers to this is that folks are playing with a concept that has forces widely distributed, operationally resilient, and politically sustainable. So if you're thinking of what's important to us, which is the first island chain out there, and people that still think that we're going to invade China haven't studied much history. The history of people invading a country with a massive landmass is pretty consistent. It's always bad. Napoleon into Russia, Hitler into the Soviet Union, any number of invaders that went into China. And we don't. There's nothing in China that we want, but what's important to us are the countries and the democracies along the first island chain. So instead of having forces all in one place, the idea is to have forces widely distributed, but also to have their own weapons that can reach out at distance and touch somebody also. And the idea that you shoot and then move, you know, those types of things. And you'll hear people talking about the contact force and the blunt force. And what they're talking about, the contact force, is people that are already in the region if a fight starts. And the blunt force are people that come in later. So the unmanned revolution is also part of this, where all the services and all the agencies that do things probably very close to here that do great scientific and engineering inquiries and things are looking at a lot of unmanned technology that will decrease the hazards to things that we're doing. So it's doable. But back to the theme that I was trying to hit on, we can't do this alone, and you can't ignore a country for a long period of time and then all of a sudden show up and say, oh, hi, by the way, we'd like to put 100,000 forces in here to pursue our own interest. And if you're not working with folks long before it becomes an emergency, then you're in bad shape. So bottom line is there are ways that we can protect the lives, the interest, and the territory of our allies and friends, but it's going to require progressively doing things much different than we did in the past. And the folks that are still in uniform and others that are in the Defense Department and other places are looking very closely at all these things, and it doing things like we did during that one exercise in the Philippines is great for demonstrating to our allies and friends that, no, we're not going to leave you out here all by yourself. We have ways to help you if you help us. The Japanese are a great case in point. They've, since 2011, they have done wonders with their defense program. Just a couple examples. One, most important, is they passed a number of laws that validated collective self-defense. The UN Charter guarantees every nation on Earth the right to collective self-defense. The Japanese had resisted doing that for a long time because of various political conditions that were created during and after World War II, but they're past that. Now, they will not, the Japanese electorate will not yet stand for a formal revision to their constitution. And every time Prime Minister Abe wants to change laws or something, his poll figures stay up. When he then says, and then there's revision of the constitution, then his poll figures go down, then he stops talking about it, and his poll figures go back up. So it's, this has happened three times now during the time he's been prime minister. So I think the message is received. But there are ways to do this, and subsidiary arguments that people like to play with is the aircraft carrier, the battleship of the future, meaning obsolete and everything. No, but you can't use it stupidly. You have to have a strategic concept on how you're going to do this. Ah.
From my very limited knowledge perspective, the U.S. defense is going to be dominated by air assets, sea assets. But just out of curiosity, I know we have a large Marine division in Okinawa, and have armies in South Korea. Is their role inherently kind of limited, or is it more than the U.S. willing to realize?
It's a great point, and it gets back to the question just previously. Is how are you going to do things in the future here? It used to be the ground forces were left on the beach, if you will, with bayonets fixed, waiting for the Navy and the Air Force to get done with their heroics, and they were there on the beach with the fixed bayonets waiting for somebody to show up. Can't do that anymore. One of the things that we consider very important and pride ourselves on is being able to integrate all the forces in the same fight. The ground forces need to be able to assume this widely distributed posture. Think Japan, which has 6,852 islands, according to National Geographic. Philippines, which has many more. You got a lot of territory to defend there. Ships and aircraft are wonderful things, but periodically they got to go somewhere else to rearm, if not to refuel. Ground forces are there, and ground forces have to have the weapons that can reach out at distance and be integrated with the weapons that the Navy and the Air Force are using so that, number one, you can cut down the odds if we're talking about conflict with China because they outnumber everybody out there. But there's plenty of work for the ground forces to do, but the weapons of the future of the ground forces will be things that if technology were to freeze today, the weapons would be long-range missiles, guided. If technology is allowed to continue past next Thursday, it's going to be things like railgun, lasers, all of these things, all thoroughly integrated with the movement of our forces, allied forces in air and on the sea, and vice versa. So in that case, we start showing our own, if you will, anti-access area denial capability, as it's called, to be able to defend the territory, the interests, and the lives of our allies and friends. So ground forces will have a big role. It will not be just the rather messy close combat. It'll be something where fully integrated into what's going on in the air and on the sea. The key to defending our allies and friends is the maintenance or at least contesting anybody else's control, unhampered control of the sea and the air. And that'd be one way to do it. Yeah. So don't sell your stock in the United States Army. There's still plenty to do.
Thank you. With your emphasis on gray area warfare and your advocacy for values-based foreign policy, are you willing at all to use gray asymmetrical warfare for the United States' own interests and benefit?
It could be called gray asymmetric. Don't link gray with warfare, though. The whole point here is it's competition. But, one of the things that deserves more attention is something called the Overseas Private Investment Corporation. This is foreign aid and investment based on the transfer of or the provision of capabilities to our allies and partners, and not bringing in our own laborers to build stuff and then going away. It's not just providing infrastructure, it's providing the skills for it. This is not necessarily a military thing. Matter of fact, it's not a military thing, but we've had success in the past with something called the Millennium Challenge Corporation, which was created by the State Department, by USAID, part of the State Department, with an awful lot of private industry investment. And there were rules provided that had to be followed if Millennium Challenge was going to work in a country, pick one at random, Mongolia, to help them develop the capability to construct roads, to build airports, to, you know, all these things. And it wasn't just how to pour cement, it was how to manage the thing, it was how to keep corruption out of the movement of finances and everything. It was wildly popular. One anecdote: a small Pacific Island nation called Vanuatu. I was there for a business, a government business, and trying to make happy talk with one of the officials, remarked that I saw a lot of construction going on at this little modest tourist hotel where I was staying, and the official smiled and says, there's fiber optic cable going in there. And he was, you know, that clearly wasn't the end of the story. And I said, and he said, that's from our friends, the Chinese. And all the cables go right through their embassy before they leave the island. Okay. And he said, yeah, and we take Chinese money because they come in, they give us buildings, and we can use the buildings. But what they were most proud of was this four-lane road that they built themselves all the way around the perimeter of their main island. And they built it. It was with Millennium Challenge assistance, but Millennium Challenge Corporation and the people working for them trained the folks on how to do this kind of thing, not just the manual labor, but the management part of it and the finance part of it. They loved the road, by the way. In the northern end of the island, there were people that didn't quite have the concept, though. They'd go out and they'd have a picnic in the middle of the road, and you had to be careful driving around certain parts of the island because they were still working this car road thing out. But that's the type of thing where I think it's at your question about competing in this gray zone, and it's something that we've allowed to atrophy. Speaking of the gray zone and China's mining of all this coral out of the South China Sea to build these structures out there, experts that know this kind of stuff say that destroying all that coral could very likely destroy the ecosystem in the South China Sea, leading to major food shortages. Nobody said anything. You didn't hear anything from Greenpeace. You didn't hear anything from Jacques Cousteau's corporation. He didn't hear anything from our government about this. Somebody should have at least brought it up. This was a violation of all sorts of rules that everybody signed up to with the UN on protecting the environment. But this was, there was thunderous silence. Yeah.
Sorry, lastly, it sounds like then that you're advocating for some kind of American form of One Belt, One Road, where it's not necessarily going to be American-dominated capital, where we're going forward and, like, the Chinese giving out, you know, direct loans, producing with our own, with our own men and equipment, but instead training people to do it on their own.
And not just American, and it's not a version of the Belt and Road Initiative, which, as you know, is developed significant problems, and countries can't pay their debts the way they were structured, except by 99-year leases on ports and airfields and things. But us and our friends, and in this and hats off to the Japanese on this with the investment they're putting into East Asia and Southeast Asia, very quietly, with two institutions, the Japanese Bank of International Cooperation and the JICA, Japanese International Cooperation Agency. The airport in Hanoi is marvelously, it's like Houston, maybe not quite as big as a Houston airport, but the terminal, but it's modern, it's new. You get in and out of it a lot faster than you do out of Dulles in Washington, D.C. San Diego's not bad, by the way, but they could get faster on a baggage claim. But this airport was built with Japanese aid on a big loan. And the road from the airport into Hanoi is about 6-8 lanes. And you ride along the road, and wow, who built this? And you get to the end of the road, and there's a very modest little stone monument. And it's got Japanese flag and a Vietnamese flag and two languages that I don't read, Japanese and Vietnamese. But it was clear that this was a cooperative project between the Japanese and the Vietnamese. And we need more of this. We made a mistake back in the day when China announced that they were going to create the Asia Infrastructure Investment Bank, AIIB. We're the richest nation in the world. We're capitalist. And instead of offering a better deal from the top of our government, we told our allies not to join the AIIB. Japan's probably our best ally out there. They joined for business reasons. We should have reinforced the Asia Development Bank, which already exists, or something else if we didn't like the AIIB. But don't tell people not to join something. Provide them a better alternative. This is kind of the capitalist thing, you know, something is faster, better, and cheaper than the competition usually sells, and we didn't do that. So BRI, it's a challenge. By the way, one of the things that's interesting about the BRI is they're moving east from China and east from the first island chain into the second island chain. There is a gigantic casino school being, and it's got some strange title that's got training institute or something in it, but it's going to be the largest collection of gaming tables in the world east of Macau. This is in Saipan, an island that's part of a territory, the Commonwealth of Northern Marianas, which is a territory of the United States. People there have U.S. passports, people that live there. And the Chinese brought in Chinese workers to build this Chinese casino. And this is clearly an attempt to create a lot of massive money flow going through there that might not necessarily be on the up and up. The people who are building this casino keep telling the residents there that you can have the casino and all the tourists to come here and all their money, or you can have the Marines up here training, but you can't have both. Is the reason they don't want the Marines there is if the Marines are there, that also brings along other government agencies like IRS, FBI, and you get supervision of the money. But the most interesting thing was that the Chinese workers they brought in to build the Chinese casino didn't like their working conditions and are suing the Chinese owner under U.S. law. Okay. This is our gray zone part. Even the Chinese laborers like our law better than their own law. So, you know, who knows about this casino and where it goes, but it's an interesting thing to watch.
Okay. I suspect you'll join me in thanking the general for an extremely interesting and entertaining talk. Thank you very much, sir.
Thanks for your time.
Thanks again for coming, and please stay tuned. We're going to have additional talk.